ostende nobis Domini misericordiam tuam. Domine exaudi oratione meam. Dominus vobiscum. Exaudi nos Domine Sancte Pater Omnipotens Eterno Deus, et mihi digneri Sanctum Angelum Tuum de Celis, qui custodiat, foveat, protegat, visitet atque defendat omnes habitantes in hoc habitaculo, per Christum Dominum Nostrum.
Santo. Di giovane dare dei. Ma ci sono le sue nome domani. Kyrie eleison.
Excelsis Deo. Potens semper tener Deus, qui abundantiae pietatis tui et merita supplicum exceris et vota, effunde super nos misericordiam tuam, ut dimittas quae conscientia metuit, et adicias cora ratio non presumit, per Domino nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivet et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Lectio Pisle Beati Pauli Apostoli a Corinthios. Fratres, notum vobis facio evangelium, quod predicavi vobis, quod et acceptistis in quo et statis, per quod et salvamini. Qua ratione predicavit in vobis, si tenetis nisi frustra crediristis. Tradidi enum vobis in primis, quod accepi, coniam Christus mortus est pro peccatis nostris secundum scripturas. Et quia sepultus est, et quia resurrexit, tertia die secundum scripturas. Et quia visus est chefe, et post hoc undecim. Deinde visus est plus quam uni, quingentis fratribus simul, et quibus multimanent usque aduc, quidam autem dormierunt. Deinde visus est Iacob, deinde apostolis omnibus. Novis me autem omnium tamquam abortivo, visus est et mihi. Ego enim sum minimus apostolorum, qui non sum dignos vocari apostolus, coniam persecutus sum ecclesiam Dei. Gratia autem Dei sum id quod sum, et gratia eius in me vacua non fui.
In Deo speravi cor meum, et in virtus sum, et perfluorvit carne mea, et exultat in mea cum putegua. Ad te, Domine, clamavi, Deus meus, nisi dias, nidiceas, et alleluia, exultat in mea, ad cor nostro, velat in mea, Iacob, sinut in psalmum, et cum putegua, ae mea, Jesus, which has
Dominus vobiscum. Sequentia Sancti Evangelii secundum Marcum. In illo tempore, exiens Iesus de finibus tiri, venit per Sidonem ad mare Galilee, inter medias fines de Capoleos, et adducunt ei surdum et mutum, et te precabunt oreum, ut imponat illi manum, et apprendens eum de turba seorsum, misit digitos suos in auricula seius, et expuens te digit linguam eius, et suspiciens in celum ingemuit, et aetili, epata, cores ad aperire, et statim aperte sunt aures eius, et solutum est vinculum linguae eius, et loque bater recte, et precepitilis nequi dicerent, quanto autem eis precipiebat, tanto magis plus predicabant, et eo amplius admirabantur dicentes, bene omnia fecit, et surdos fecit audire et mutos loqui.
Translation of the first epistle of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brethren, I make known unto you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast after what manner I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, and after that by the 11. Then he was seen by more than 500 brethren at once, of whom many remain until this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen also by me, as by one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace in me hath not been void. The translation of the Gospel according to St. Mark. At that time, Jesus, going out to the coasts of Tyre, came by Sidon to the Sea of Galilee, through the midst of the coasts of Decapolis, and they bring to him one deaf and dumb, and they besought him that he would lay his hand upon him. And taking him from the multitude apart, he put his fingers into his ears, and spitting, he touched his tongue, and looking up to heaven, he groaned and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "Be thou opened." And immediately his ears were opened, and the string of his tongue was loosed, and he spoke right. And he charged them that they should tell no man. But the more he charged them, so much the more a great deal did they publish it, and so much the more did they wonder, saying, "He hath done all things well. He hath made both the deaf to hear and the dumb to speak." They brought to him a man who was deaf and dumb, and they besought him that he would lay his hand upon him, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. This is the miracle of the healing of the deaf mute, painted by Maggiotto, by Philippe de Champagne, and it was famous, at least once, in all of our civilization. The miracle of the healing of the deaf mute. But what does this miracle mean? And why does the Lord speak to us with this miracle this morning here at St. Stanislaus? For that is what he is doing. Well, to understand this miracle, we have to look at the gestures, the physical actions, the gestures of Jesus. We have to look at how the Lord acts. First of all, it is impossible to enter into dialogue with a deaf, mute man. At least it's impossible through words. So what does Jesus do? The Lord adapts himself to the man's situation. He uses gestures, his hands. He puts his fingers into the man's ears. He touches the man's tongue with his own saliva, and that's exactly what it says in the gospel. And he stimulates the man's faith in this way. He restores his senses, absolutely, but he stimulates his faith. And why does that matter? Well, the Lord Jesus is not an ordinary healer. He is not exclusively concerned with freeing this poor man from his bodily disability. The Lord Jesus Christ came to save our souls first and foremost. That is why, whenever he performs miracles, the Lord's desire is to awaken us in our souls. He wakes us up. He revitalizes our faith. He gives it new life. But Jesus heals also with discretion. And you can see that in this gospel too. The Lord shows respect for this individual man in all his frailness. Again, look at his gestures. The first thing that Jesus did was, and I'm quoting, to take the man aside in private, away from the crowd. And that's the way that he could deal personally with the deaf, mute man. Now, if you think about it, this is also the way the Lord deals with us, always, one on one. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, says the Lord. And before you were born, I consecrated you, says the Lord through his prophet Jeremiah. In the silence of my room, all alone, it is God who hears me. It is God who talks to me when I'm alone in the car, or a long and lonely corridor, or a long, hard pew. And it is there in my solitude that God, the Lord Jesus, can reach out and heal me. But now, how did this healing happen, other than the fact that it was in private? Look again at what Jesus is telling us by his actions. The evangelist records that the Lord looked up. The Lord looked up to heaven. And this is a gesture that is very characteristic of the Lord Jesus. He lifted his eyes upward when he was about to multiply the bread. He lifted his eyes upward before raising Lazarus. He lifted his eyes towards heaven before what is called his high priestly prayer, immediately after the Last Supper in the Gospel of John, when Jesus prayed for the future church, in other words, for us. He lifted up his eyes, and by lifting his eyes to heaven, the Lord Jesus showed that he was the Son of God, who came from the Father, and that he did nothing in his own name. Now, I am sure that you noticed this. St. Mark's Gospel is more figurative. It is more blunt than the other Gospels. So, in the description of the healing of the deaf mute man, we read, "His ears were opened and the string of his tongue was loosed." It's a strong image, and some people squirm a little bit. It is worth knowing that both of these images, the ears and the tongue, are associated by Christians from the earliest days with what? With a sacrament. And not just any sacrament, with the sacrament of baptism. Yes, with baptism. And here's the secret. Today's gospel is in fact an allegory of baptism. It foreshadows the sacrament without which none of the other six sacraments can be received. We read it again. "Jesus groaned and said to him, Ephphatha." Ephphatha, it's Aramaic. That is, "Be thou opened." Well, baptism opens us to saving grace. We can now put ourselves right in the place of the deaf mute. Baptism is where we hear Christ shout, Ephphatha, at us personally. And now what about this business of putting fingers into the ears? You tell your boys not to put their fingers in your ears, but Christ stuck his fingers in your ears on the day that you were baptized. Thanks to the sacrament of baptism, our ears have been opened so that we can hear and understand the word of God. Thanks to the sacrament of baptism, we are listening to an explication of the word of God even now, however poor it might be. And more than that, it is because of the fingers of Christ in our ears, because my ears have been opened, that I can hear, that I can understand the cry of the poor, as the Lord does, and understand how to serve. I can hear and understand also how to love, rather than remaining deaf. Imagine, Jesus touches your ear. He clears resistance, and you hear love, for the touch of Jesus on your ear is the touch of love, and it is the touch of life. And it gives you a sense of hearing that is not just adequate, not merely as good as it might have been before. No, Jesus, the Lord, creates for you an entirely new hearing, a totally new hearing. You hear with new ears, as it says in the Old Testament. You hear now subtleties and detect the echoes of beauties that you never perceived before. And now what about this gesture involving the tongue and spittle? And yes, we're going to talk about it. I quote, "Jesus took the deaf mute aside so they could be by themselves, put his fingers into the man's ears, and touched his tongue with spittle." Spittle. The ancient fathers of the church tell us, I quote, "The spittle is heavenly wisdom, which loosens the sealed lips of the human race so that we can say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty." We'll call that open to interpretation. It's mysterious, but It is by this mysterious gesture that the deaf mute man was healed, and he was healed immediately. And the formerly dumb man, the formerly totally silent man, spoke, and you just heard it. He spoke so much, apparently, that Jesus had to warn him not to go blab about the miracle to everyone. But it didn't work. We heard it. Jesus charged him that he should tell no man, but the more he charged him, so much the more, a great deal, did he publish it, and so much the more did they wonder. People were astounded by the miracle, and this formerly disabled man told anyone who would listen what God had done for him and revealed Jesus' identity, even though Jesus specifically told him not to do it. Now, was that bad to proclaim Jesus to other people, since the man was actually disobeying what Jesus told him directly? Was it bad? Perhaps so. Perhaps so. But perhaps the Lord Jesus knew that this man's example would serve as a lesson to us all these centuries later. Lesson about what? About zeal in speaking to others about God. This is not my own idea. It comes from St. Augustine, the great father of the church. He spoke about this part of the gospel, which he read just like we do, and we have a record of his commentary in a book called The Golden Chain. And I'm quoting St. Augustine. He says, "If, however, the Lord, as one who knew the present and the future wills of men, knew that this deaf-mute man would proclaim him more and more in proportion as he forbade him, then why did the Lord give the healed man the command not to proclaim in the first place?" And St. Augustine continues. He answers the question, "Why else, if it were not that the Lord wished to prove to men who are idle in preaching, and yet who are not forbidden but actually commanded by God to preach and commanded to proclaim him, he wanted to show them how much more joyfully and," says St. Augustine, "with how much greater obedience they should shout the Lord's name and proclaim the Lord's teachings. After all, even the greatly burdened man of the gospel, who was explicitly forbidden to tell about the Lord, could not hold his peace and could not stop telling the people about Jesus." So thus far, St. Augustine. We can use this gospel as a chance to pray for preachers. And don't be afraid to exhort and to encourage preachers when you meet them, but I would add, when you meet them outside of Mass, if you please. And the singers sing in an old song, which is called The Old Landmark. It's an Afro-American spiritual. The singers sing, "Preachers preach." It's an exhortation. "Preachers preach," and they add, "and preach it in the old-time way." You can make of that what you will. Now, do we participate? Do we all participate in this aspect of the miracle too, the healing of the tongue? Oh yes, we do. By the grace of the sacrament of baptism, the bonds of our tongues have been loosed. Baptism opens our mouths. In the traditional rite of baptism, and there are many babies, I can hear them in this church, who probably were baptized in the traditional rite, salt is blessed. Right before the candidates enter the baptistry, salt is blessed with an exorcism, and a pinch of this salt can be put in the mouth of the baby. Salt in the mouth of a little baby about to be baptized. After baptism, our mouths are purified. Our mouths have become capable of uttering prayers pleasing to God. After baptism, our tongues become capable of speaking words that serve love. We can be peacemakers and use well-chosen words to promote harmony. "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God," says the Lord. We can use our tongues also to teach. So at the end of this homily, and that is the end of this long homily, our ears have been given back to us by Jesus. Our tongues have been restored and healed by Jesus so that they could perform their original function, unhindered by disease, unhindered by sin. But what about the disease of sin? We can't finish today without mentioning that. We need to protect ourselves, all of us. We need to protect ourselves and especially to ask the Lord, to shield us from sin. Sin can close our ears. Sin can bind our tongue again. Sin can imprison us and shut us down and lock us down and deafen us again and again. But we have a choice. We have a choice. Today, let us choose to draw closer to Jesus and to draw our friends closer to Jesus, as happened physically in the gospel today. The man's friends brought him to Jesus and placed him at the feet of Christ. Let us choose the grace of God, not sin. Let us choose the healing of Jesus, and then let us open our ears to him and welcome and receive his teaching. Then let our tongues be healed and speak freely the words of peace. And so we pray in the words of the 51st Psalm. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you. Save me from blood guilt, O God, the God who saves me, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
per omnia saecula saeculorum. Dominus vobiscum. Sursum corda. Gratias agamus Domino Deo nostro. Vere dignum et justum est, ecum et salutare, nos tibi semper tibi gratias agere. Domine Sancte Pater Omnipotens et Bene Deus, qui cum unigenito Filio Tuo, et Spiritus Sancto unus est Deus, unus est Dominus, non in unius singularitate personae, sed in unius Trinitate substantiae, quod enim de tua gloria revelante te credimus, hoc de Filio tuo, hoc de Spiritu Sancto, sine differentia discretioni sentimus, ut in confessione vere sempiterneque deitatis, et in personis proprietas, et in essentia unitas, et in maiestate adoretur requalitas, quam laudant angeli atque arcangeli, cherubim quoque ac serfim, qui non cessant clamare quotidie una voce dicentes. Per omnia saecula saeculorum. Oremus, precepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Per omnia saecula saeculorum. Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Indulgentium absolutum in vis vectorum nostrorum tribut vobis omnipotens et misericus Dominus. Ecce annus Dei, ecce quid olivat mundi, Domino non sunt dignus, et nunc est meum, et stabile quae habet clavia arm mea.
Thank you.
Essentiamus quae sumus Domine, tui perceptioni sacramenti subsidimentis et corporis, ut in utroque salvati celestis remeri plenitudine gloriemur. Et Domino nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum. Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Dominus vobiscum. Et sum sanctae Evangelii secundum Iohannem.